Praise the Lord. Good morning and welcome to the house of the Lord. We thank God for giving us another Sunday, another beautiful day that we can come together to worship Christ our Lord. This morning's scripture reading will be taken from the book of Psalms, chapter 36. Psalms 36, we will be reading from verses 5 to 9. Psalms 36, verses 5 to 9, we can all read together. And as we read, let's reflect on the words that speak out to you. And give ear to the reading, because this describes to us the characteristics of God, who God is. So let's read together verses 5 to 9. Your love, Lord, reaches to the heavens, your faithfulness to the skies. Your righteousness is like the highest mountains, your justice like the great deep. You, Lord, preserve both people and animals. How priceless is your unfailing love, O God! People take refuge in the shadow of your wings. They feast on the abundance of your house and give them drink from your river of delights. For with you is the fountain of life, and in your light we see light. May the Lord bless the reading of his word. Psalms 36 that we read is a psalm of David, where David is reflecting on the fruits of the wicked. And he's also looking at the reward of the righteousness, of the righteous. Now, verses 1 to 4 that we didn't read, but in the beginning, David says that, I have a message from God in my heart concerning the sinfulness of the wicked. There is no fear of God before their eyes. But in verses 5 to 9 that we read, it talks about who God is, his characteristics, and his blessings upon his children and to the righteous. Verse 5 says, his love reaches to the heavens, and his faithfulness stretches to the skies. Verse 6 says, his righteousness is like a mighty mountain, his justice like the ocean tides or the ocean deep. So when I read this, talking about his love, his faithfulness, his righteousness, comparing to something that really cannot be compared. His love reaches to the heavens. So what does that mean? Heaven is so high, you can get over it. His love never fails. And then when he talks about the heavens, faithfulness stretches to the skies. How far can you stretch? You can never reach. His faithfulness is so much. And his righteousness, I love this, it's a mighty mountain. So when I say, what's a mighty mountain? Wow, the Alps, Mount Everest, solid. That's what his righteousness is. And he's a just God. And his justice is like the ocean deeps or the ocean tides. That is the God that we serve. The fool has said in his heart that there is no God. But the righteous will enjoy the goodness of the Lord. So this morning, let us come before the Lord knowing who God is and before whom are we approaching this morning. Let's bring sacrifices of praise unto the Lord. This is the fruit of your lips that acknowledges who God is, the name of Jesus that's above every other name. Let us pray. Praise your Lord. Let's just praise the Lord as we read. Praise, when you offer praise, it's the fruit of your lips coming from your heart. Praise your Lord, O Father. Lord, we praise your Lord. Praise your Lord. Praise your Lord. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Blessed be thy holy name. Lord, we give you glory, O Lord. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for your love, O Lord, O Father. Oh, it is as high as the heavens, O Lord. Thank you, Lord, your faithfulness. Lord, we thank you for your unfailing love, your mercies, O Lord, O Father. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be your name, O Lord, O Father. We thank you for your love. We thank you for your mercies, your faithfulness. Oh, your righteousness towards us, O Lord, O Father. Lord, this morning we bring sacrifice of praise unto you. Lord, we magnify you this morning. We exalt your holy name, O Lord. We lift up our voice to worship you, our King. Lord, we find our strength in the shadow of your wings, O Lord, O Father. Thank you, Lord, this morning. Take delight in our worship and praise, O Lord, O Father. Lord, we pray you anoint the service this morning. Minister to the needs of the people, O Lord, O Father. Lord, we bring, O Lord, O Father, anoint the service, O God. Anoint this morning, minister to every family. Lord, we pray for healing, healing for those that are sick in the body, O Lord. Lord, we pray for comfort, O Lord, for those that are grieving, that are hurting, O Lord. We bring peace, O Lord, to those that are troubled in their hearts. Lord, we bring joy, O Lord, O Father, to those that are saddened, O Lord, O Jesus. Thank you, Lord, this morning. Oh, for dear pastor, O Lord, O Father. Lord, after 2 to 3 months, he's back to preach to us the word this morning. Anoint him, O Lord, as he brings forth the word. The power of the Holy Spirit be upon him as he speaks, O Lord. Strengthen him, O Lord, O Father. Thank you for the worship team, O Lord, as they lead us in worship. May we enter into your presence with praise, O Lord. Thank you for the tech team. Thank you for the ushers, O Lord. Thank you for all who are serving you faithfully, O Lord, O Father, we praise you. Lord, we thank you for your presence in our midst. Minister to our needs, O Lord. We thank you, we praise you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Praise the Lord. The worship team will lead us in worship and praise.
Amen. We can all stand together as we sing. As we just heard, it is really true that the love of God, his faithfulness, sometimes we can't even fully comprehend it, even in the Bible, it's hard to have words to describe that or capture that. And maybe sometimes it's hard for us to believe that or to comprehend his love or to have that hope. And I like this verse in Ephesians. It says, "For it is by grace that you have been saved through faith, and this is not from yourselves. It is the gift of God." And so this morning, faith is not something that God expects us to muster up or that we have to use our thinking to make us believe or hope. If you need faith this morning, if you need hope this morning, it is a gift of God. And so I pray that we sing these songs together. As it says, God, let hope arise and let faith become that fortress of our heart. And that's our prayer as we sing together this morning.
Lift my eyes. it's the ocean wide, just to bring us closer to your side. You're the God who brings the dead to life, we believe. You are the great things you have done. For everything we've seen, there is more to come. Every victory, every battle won. For everything we've seen, there is more to
Lord Jesus, we believe, God, that there is more to come, Father. And Lord, this morning we put our hope and we put our trust, Lord, not on something that is uncertain, Father, but we put our hope and our trust in a good Father, in a loving Father, a faithful Father. Lord, so we rest and we trust in your unchanging character, your unchanging faithfulness, and your unchanging love.
Tender whisper of love.
Jesus, we thank you, God, that you are God, Lord. You are a good Father, Lord. Lord, we are your children, Father. We are your sheep, Father. We are your prized possession, Lord, and we are loved by you, God. Lord, I pray for every person here this morning, Father. Lord, I pray if there's any confusion in their identity, Father, Lord, if there's any confusion, if they are known to you, Father, if you see them, Father, I pray, God, that as we, Lord, hear the message, as we hear your word, Father, Lord, all doubts, all confusion, Father, would go away, and each person would know, Father, Lord, that they are loved by you, Father, that you gave your one and only Son, Lord, for them, Father. Give us ears to hear your word and hearts to respond this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Praise the Lord, good morning. Welcome, welcome. My computer is slower than me, so I have to wait a little bit, a second. Sorry for the patience. Thank you for your patience. For those who are watching us online, welcome. Today is the last Sunday of the month of October. Can you believe that? We are only 61 days before the new year 2022. We thank God for carrying us through this pandemic year for the past 10 months. That's why, as we read in the Psalms, we thank God for His unfailing love, His mercies. We thank God for His faithfulness. We thank God for His righteousness. We thank God He's a just God. And we thank God that we can come together again this morning to worship the Lord. For those who are here for the very first time, if you are here for the first time, raise your hand so we can see you and recognize you. If not, thank you all for coming. And for those who are online, if you are here joining us for the first time, welcome. Welcome in Jesus' name. Our weekly Zoom meetings and schedules, they continue as follows. We have the ICF family prayer every Wednesday, 7:30 p.m., and the intercessory prayer fellowship Friday mornings at 10:30. For those who are free and available, we welcome you to come and join us. Join us to intercede, join us to pray together for the needs of the church, your needs, and we can be united in prayer. The journey groups, they meet on Tuesdays and Fridays in different areas, so your leaders will reach out to you with details. The focus youth ministries, they meet on Saturdays. Again, the leaders will update you on those meetings. So this Saturday is Wings Women's Ministries, Saturday, November 6, 6:30 p.m. here at church. So all the ladies come together so you can be united in this fellowship and be blessed. We continue to worship the Lord with our giving through our tithes and offerings. That is a form of worship. We worship unto the Lord and thank God for what He has gifted us and all His heavenly blessings. So you can either give online or later we'll be passing the bag when after Pastor has given the message. The SOAR Children's Ministry, Sunday School Ministry, wow, is going to start in person. Oh, praise God. I'll call Manju to come and give details on the Sunday School back to worship in person. Come on, Manju.
Good morning, everyone. It's very exciting to be able to make this announcement. For the past 1.5 years, we were meeting on Zoom. But I thank God for technology that we didn't have to miss. We probably missed a week or at most two, you know, of Sunday school when we went into lockdown. I thank God for keeping us all safe and for helping us to meet on Zoom these past 1.5 years. So next week, God willing, after much prayer, we have decided to meet in person. So I'm guessing all the kids are excited to do that. And we have a few changes with the room assignments when we meet, and few other changes too. We will sit with our parents for worship time. We will not sit together like we used to do before, but you will sit with your parents, and after the worship time, we will go to the classrooms, and our classroom assignments are a little different too. We don't have as much facility available right now, so the Hawks will meet in the fellowship hall, and Sparrows, Falcons, and Eagles will meet in the second building, second preschool building, and we will show you where you will go next week as we go, because it's a little different than what we had before. So I thank God for that. I want to especially thank the community church for making these facilities available to us and for all that they do to, you know, make sure that everything runs smoothly as multiple people are using this facility. They have always been gracious. I also want to remind our kids and parents to be, you know, responsible and be thankful to them and use the facilities, you know, with utmost care and respect. The youth group, as and when they meet, they can use the fireside room. Depending on your leaders, we'll let you know about that. I also want to thank Sherchain for being the, you know, a person who always talks to the community church and makes sure all our facilities are available to us at the right time and, you know, making all the arrangements for us. And I want to request the parents, if at all your kids are sick, you know, in any way, please keep them home, because it's a hassle these days. Even if it's a cold, you have to go for COVID test, all these things. So we just want to make sure everybody is safe and we can continue to enjoy the fellowship that we do. Thank you, Pastor and Blessy, for all you do, for your encouragement and support during this time. I want to say a word of thanks to the tech team too. You know, as we move to in-person, I don't want to forget all that they have done, especially to Noble, you know, who has put in a lot of hours and time to host our Zoom meetings and to be there to do things for us. David and Pratima doing the Bible study online, you know, on Fridays. So want to thank each one of you for what you have been doing, and we look forward. Keep us in prayers that God will continue to protect us and help us move to a normalcy in the coming days. One more thing, we will keep our masks on while we are in the classrooms too. So masks on for everybody. That is the expectation too. Thank you.
Amen. Thank you very much. You know, it's very significant because nearly 2 years they were meeting on Zoom. Coming back in person means things are coming back to normalcy. And that's what we thank the Lord for, that we can come together. October is Pastors Appreciation Month. And today, we are going to take time out to appreciate our dear pastor, who has been away on medical and a very challenging times this year for the past 2 to 3 months. And we are glad that he's back here, and I'm sure he's wiser here today, because he has learned many things during his time of rest, when he couldn't meet with a lot of people, meet with a lot of other activities. So this morning we want to recognize him, and there's a couple of representations this morning who will come and say a few words. David and Pradima, they will come and speak a few words on behalf of SAW Ministries. And after that, Vijay brother will come representing ICF. So David and Pradima, please come up.
Good morning, church. Today is October 31st, a special day to dress up and celebrate.
You mean for Halloween?
No, I'm talking about Pastor Appreciation Day. You know, we have a great pastor, so.
Yeah, we're very honored to be representing our favorite ministry. And also, we know it's a ministry that is very close to Pastor's heart, our awesome SOAR Children's Ministry. And I think it's a testament to the passion and vision of Pastor and Manjuati. So we're very grateful to be a part of that. So we're going to stop talking now, and we're going to let the real stars do the talking, our ICF kids.
So this past week, you know, it was pretty late. You know, we appreciate that the kids, you know, we asked them to send in a one-word description describing Pastor. And so we put together a video of, you know, the kids who turned it in. And, you know, all the kids love you, Pastor, because it was done in the last minute. Some kids couldn't participate, but we all love you. And, you know, we wanted Pastor and the church to enjoy it. Josh, hit it.
Today, we celebrate and are grateful for a very
special
person. He is a
dedicated
and
caring hard worker
in the church. He is also very
hardworking
at home. Well, we'll have to ask Blessy Auntie about that. Just kidding. He is a truly
amazing,
affectionate,
benevolent
person who we kids absolutely adore. He's the
best neighbor
ever in the holy city of Escondido. His sense of humor is absolutely
delightful.
He is an example of living like Jesus. He has a
nice beard.
He is a
prayer warrior
and teaches us to be
strong,
confident,
and fight Satan with prayer when he acts like a
bully.
That was so
funny.
He is the
coolest
pastor in the whole world who is always
on fleek.
Drum roll, please, for Pastor Alex.
Hey, Pastor Uncle, thank you for encouraging us to follow Jesus every day of our lives.
Hey, man. I'm man.
We love you so much, Pastor Uncle.
Praise the Lord. Good morning, church. Yeah, it was awesome. And I don't know, like, you know, what else I can cover. I thank God for this wonderful opportunity and the privilege that God has given to me to speak a few words to appreciate our pastor, our dear pastor, Alexander John. And the things why we do in this church, it's not just for the sake of doing the things, but scripturally we do the things. When Paul wrote his first letter to Timothy, he mentioned about how to honor the people around us, especially, you know, during the time of church, like, you know, in the church, especially how to honor the people. So let us look at the scripture. 1 Timothy chapter 5 verse 17. From NIV, I'm reading this. The elders who direct the affairs of the church well are worthy of double honor, especially those whose work is preaching and teaching. I think, you know, many of us are both in the, you know, eldership and leadership roles in the church. And we know, like, how hard it is, you know, to do the things and to dedicate our time and all that. So that could be the reason why the scripture says that they are really deserve the double honor. Today, on behalf of ICF entire family, we are giving you this double honor of the honor of respect and the honor of love, the honor of remuneration or the love. That's what we wanted to give you, Pastor, and this special appreciation day would like to bring. When you know, it was given to me that you have to talk about the appreciation on the pastors, you know, I never did this before, and I'm really not a good fan of appreciating the people if they do what they are supposed to do. I really don't have words also. So I'm really tense that I am really dumb. So I was praying to God, like, you know, God, give me something. How can I appreciate our pastor or something like that? I was praying, and also I thought that, you know, I will be representing the whole church. So I was asking God, and God really helped me by showing this verse to me. From the scripture, you know, Hebrews chapter 13 verse 7 says that. Hebrews chapter 13 verse 7. It says, remember your leaders who spoke the word of God to you. Consider the outcome of their way of life and imitate their faith. Whatever I'm going to share here, this is my journey of 10 plus years with Pastor Alex. And also, I think, it's the same feeling for each one of you also. I see in this 10 years of time, consistently these qualities in Pastor, the passion. Pastor is a man of passion, and his desire to do God's will, and his desire to expand the God's kingdom, that which was given to him. You know, as we read in the verse, like, you know, the who directs the affairs of the church, he is everywhere. If you look into that, like, you know, most of us are like down sometimes, but pastor comes up with a new attitude and new skills, you know, new things that he brings into our lives. And also, he's a man of principles. He disciplines his life in such a way that, like, we just saw that he's hardworking, he's a smart working. On top of these things, he's a good working. That's what he's called for. He's a good working pastor. Like, he's everywhere whenever there is a need for a one of the member of this family, you know, he will be there. He's the first guy. And, yeah, and he's also a man of strategy. He's a planning, you know. He comes up with a plan a year ahead of time. Like, you know, whenever he plans for the church activities, a year ahead he will come and he will discuss about this planning. He plans for every ministry. He does not really only worries about his preaching and teaching. He will be involved with every leader in a different ministries. And he comes up with a plan. And last but not the least, is a man of prayer. He is an interceder. And his faith, you know, I believe that, like, you know, he motivates us in such a way that, you know, you will fall for Jesus Christ. That's how he disciplined his life and his prayer life. I think, like, you know, there are many more qualities of pastor we can talk about, but it's a really, you know, the time was very less, so I just wrote a few sentences to appreciate pastor. I believe that, you know, pastor, dear pastor, Blessie Anderson, and Jaden and Alexis. See, I believe that whatever the pastor, the ministry that God has entrusted to pastor, it's not only, you know, it's very hard to carry a ministry alone in this world. So I believe that his backbone is his family. Blessie, Anderson, Jaden, and Alexis. I believe that Blessie's submission and the respect that she gives to his ministry, that gives him success in whatever he does. And also Anderson, Jaden, and Alexis, their obedience to his call is also making everyone, you know, to see them as a model in the church. And I just wanted to say these things. Pastor and family, you are a great blessing to many of our lives. You are a great gift that God has given to ICF. You are a great inspiration to our faith in Jesus Christ. From an elementary child to an old man, individually and collectively, you inspire a lot with your way of life. Your sacrifice are countless to the kingdom of God. Your dedication and preparation to deliver God's message is powerful and wonderful. Your learning and teaching motivates and encourages us to dig in deeper into the God's word. From the bottom of our hearts, I wanted to appreciate pastor and family for all the teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness that you do for ICF family. Our wish and God's bless will lead you into success as you manifest yourself with a newness of spirit for the kingdom of God. Thank you.
Thank you, Vijay and David and Pradima. We not only want to appreciate pastor with words, we also want to appreciate him in kind. So the church has put together a gift for pastor, and if you wonder what is in here, a lot of nice wrapping papers, but the good things are heavy, so it's under the papers. So we have got him a new iPad so he can work faster and more and be more efficient, and a monetary gift. Come, pastor. Praise the Lord. Welcome. Amen. Thank you. On behalf of the church.
Thank you.
Yeah, so pastor is going to bring the word. He has not spoken for nearly 3 months. Pray that his voice will not fail. Amen. God bless.
Thank you so much. I am in the clouds, so let me take some time to come down. Really honored and to be blessed to be part of the kingdom of God and also to shepherd the church of the living God. Usually we don't do these kinds of things on Sundays because I personally believe that Sunday is to worship the Lord. It is not about anybody or anything else. But we used to have a Saturday service those days, so we do business on Saturdays. But we don't have a Saturday service, that's why we try to do these things on Sundays. And personally, again, I don't like that either. But at the same time, there is a balance we have to understand. The Bible teaches this, you know, because Bible mentions a lot of people's name throughout the scripture. And some of the names, we don't even know who they are. Some of the names, we can't even pronounce it. You know, even read this genealogy and other things that we read. But we come to the New Testament also, we see that Paul writes one of the greatest letters that he wrote is Romans. The last chapter in Romans 16 that we read, he at least mentioned more than 30 people in that place. And mentioning them by name, by name, by name, and their houses, what they have done for the kingdom of God. So they appreciate that. So appreciating people, what they have done, what they are doing while they are alive is very important. Usually, you know, especially from a Malayali culture, we talk good things about after people die. You know, what about other Indian culture, how they does actually. So the funeral service is long because after they die, you only talk about their good things. So it's good to talk when they are alive. So that's a good thing. At the same time, but I want to mention that this is not about me or Blessy or us. This is 18 years now we have been here together. God has brought each of us in different times and places here for the glory of God. God has brought us together. So I truly believe that each of you are a gift to us. And we have mentioned the history and the story of the church many, many times. I don't have to repeat that again and again. But I just want to thank God, each of you, for our elders, for each of the leaders, those who are faithfully serving the Lord. So I will mention that at the, you know, in a few minutes later. So understand that we all are part of this. God has called us. As Paul writes to Timothy, he says that God has counted us faithful and entrusted us with this ministry. So each of us, those who are here, we all are ministers. God has entrusted with this ministry. So God, in his grace, gave us the opportunity to involve in the ministry. So we all are involved. So God will not do apart from us. We cannot do anything without him either. So that is a partnership. Paul writes to Corinthians again. He says that we are co-laborers with Jesus Christ. We are co-laborers with Jesus Christ. So, but doesn't matter that everything depends upon us. We are involved. God has graciously given us the opportunity. That doesn't mean that is depend upon us. You know, we all will go one day. The ministers will die and bury, but the mission will always continue. So God has brought us here in this season of life, and let us thank the Lord for that. So my prayer and our prayer, our burden is that, you know, and thank God for us as well. You know, that was truly amazing. So I will send to all of my people, actually look at that, people talking about me, right? So it's amazing, my children. So when for my 50th birthday, the picture you guys made, actually, that is in front of me, actually, where I sit. So every single day, this is not to boast or anything, to flatter to say, actually, every single day, that is what my delight to see them and pray for them every single day. So years ago, we said about this, actually, 10 years from now, where we are going to be. So I think that this is a crucial time of our church. And we have to think and pray about it, next 10 years of life. Last week, when I saw the sore, you know, the people, those who are talking on the video, it was amazing, you know, the sound is changed. There's a deep voice and their size and sound, everything is changing. Look around and see that 10 years from now, where ICF will be. All these, sparrows, all these small ones go to middle school and high schools. Those who are in the middle schools, they will be in college. Those who are in high school, they will be married. You know, they get job. They may move out from the San Diego, and we end up like the community church of Pave, these old folks sitting simply here. Is that what we want to? No. We want it to invest in their life, and they want to come back. This would be their church. So just envision that. 10 years from now, these children are going to be the backbone, the future of this church. So we have to pray and pray for them and stand together for them. That is our burden. That is the purpose. That is the passion. That is the prayer that we have for them, for all our children. They will be serving God faithfully. That is what we do. So again, we want to thank each of you for your love, for your support, for your care. As Uncle said, I learned a lot of things last 2.5 months, actually. You know, what I learned was like, Blessy can talk. That is what I learned last 2.5 months. Because all these years we got married, she never got a chance to talk. And so I was always speaking. So she started to speak. That was the greatest revelation actually I had. So she can speak. So I learned a lot of that. And first 3-4 weeks of the surgery, I couldn't speak much actually. Then I was trying to eager because I was pumping up a lot of things to speak. So I have a lot of things to say in the days to come, also what I have learned. And next 10 years of the ministry, you know, and that is what I'm praying also. Next 10 years of ministry for me, for us and the family, what we want to do. This is what I want to do next 10 years of ministry. Repeat everything that I have said. I'm going to preach any new sermons at all because I am thinking actually whatever we know, we have to apply that in our life. That is what it is we want to do. You know, everything that we know, how we are able to apply that in our life. So everything what I'm going to say is should be keep it simple and short. That would be the thing. So next 10 years, where we are going to end, what we are going to do, how we are going to apply these things into our life. So that is what we want to do. So for the church again, you know, this was difficult. The post-pandemic world is a challenging time. And every church is changed that we can see. We change. A lot of things will change. So we want to make a dedication, recommitment as we come back for Sunday school. Other things, we are slowly coming back to the normalcy. So we want to thank the Lord together today. So this is not again me, and we are as a team that we do these things together. We are together for the glory of God. So I want all the elders and their families to stand up with me, please. All the elders and families, please stand up. Yeah. Your families also, because we are not doing by ourselves actually, all the family members, all of you, you can stand, you know. All the elders, all the youth leaders and their families, stand up please. All the youth leaders. You don't take much time, so I will preach until 2 o'clock otherwise if you don't stand up fast. All the SOAR teachers, you know, and leaders, you know, and all of them, you please stand. And their families, all the families, you know, all the hospitality team and their families. You know, our tech team, you know, our youngsters, the new team, and the worship team and their families, would you please stand up? Our men's fellowship and families, and the ladies' fellowship, and everything, you know, look at that, all of us are together, let's all stand together now. Let's all stand together. This is not a church, but never tell anybody I am going to Pastor Alex Church. That is a, you know, blasphemy. Church belongs to God. ICF is the Lord's church, right? So we also say that we are the part of this church. Let us make a rededication today. That next 10 years of life, not for this year actually. Of course, this is the, you know, last Sunday of this month. So let us pray together this morning. And God has graciously called us to be his ambassadors and ministry. Every Christian is a minister. Remember that. Every Christian is a minister. You know, you are part of ICF. That means this family, this place. And God has brought you here. So let us pray together this morning. Pray for our children especially. All the children, pray for your teachers, your leaders, for the elders. And all of these dear ones, you know, our missions, everything that is happening here because of your sacrifice, because of your commitment, because of your dedication. And I always boast to my other pastor friends, actually, the church that I pastor, the church I have, is a run 100% on volunteers. 100% on volunteers. I think that is, we are the only church in this area like that. They have staff, they have secretary, all kinds of things. But we are together as the ambassadors of Christ. Let us pray that, Lord, thank you for giving us the opportunity to serve him. Let us praise the Lord together this morning. Let us thank the Lord together. Let's make a dedication today. Pray for one another. A new sense of love. A new sense of unity. A new sense of purpose in our heart, in our life to serve the Lord in the days to come. God has called us, set apart for this ministry. Our life is so short. You know, next 10 years is 520 weeks. You know, so it will go very fast. As I said, the children will grow and go fast. So let us pray that, Lord, the time that we have together, we'll represent you well. We'll love the Lord with all our heart, mind, and strength. And love one another as we love ourselves. And we share his love to this community where God has placed us. Let us rededicate our life for that together. Again, thank the Lord to appreciate one another for the ministry, for the sacrifices, the love, the prayer. And I pray for Anil and Biju. You know, he has a great heart for each of you to pray week after week. And that burden that we can see that. Thank God for him. And each of you. Everyone, you know, John Engel sir was the lay pastor, you know, for his love and compassion and care for each of you. And every one of you, I don't want to name one by one, we may forget. So I just thank the Lord for each of you. Let us thank the Lord for them together, church. Let us pray to open your mouth and praise the Lord together. His faithfulness, his righteousness, his mercy, his love towards us. God has enable us to serve him 18 years in this city. It is not a small thing. Every step of the way to ask the Lord. We planned, we prayed, we organized a lot of things. But I believe that everything fall in place at the right time. God brought the right people at the right time, various times. You know, we thank the Lord for that. Let us praise the Lord for their sacrifices, faithfully serving the Lord and his kingdom. Father, we come together this morning as your children. Lord, we have nothing to boast other than your cross, O God. Lord, only you know our past, present, and future. Lord, you are the Jehovah Jireh, the one who provides for us. Lord, you are the Alpha and the Omega. You are the beginning and the end. Lord, we came here for a sustenance. We came here to survive here, to live and make money and raise our children. But you have a great plan and purpose for us. You brought us here to represent you in this city, O God. Lord, we know that there are more than 25,000 Indian people live in the greater San Diego area. Lord, today we rededicate our life again. Lord, we will not be just comfortable in our comforts and our things, and we concerned about only our own things and success, O God. Rather, Lord, we will live for your glory. Lord, the gospel of Jesus Christ will be our passion. Lord, that will be the breath every day in our life, O Father. We will be compassionate like you to reach out this community for the gospel of Jesus Christ. Lord, I pray for this next generation you have entrusted with us. Lord, we are mere managers. You are the owner. They are your children, O Father. Lord, I pray for the young to the old, each one of them we pray for right now. Lord, they will carry the torch of the gospel of Jesus Christ in this place. Lord, they will be the elders. They will be the leaders. Lord, they will proclaim the gospel. We will be able to stand here and see what the Lord is doing through their lives, O Father. Lord, bless them, we pray today. Lord, we pray education. Lord, their future, their career, their life partners. Lord, we pray that you bless each of them. Lord, we pray for all our elders. Lord, our leaders. Lord, our worship team, our tech team. Lord, all these people you have raised up and their passion and burden to serve you, O God. Lord, I pray that you bless them. Establish the work of their hands, we pray, in the name of Jesus, we pray, Lord. We pray that you continue to stand in unity for the gospel of Jesus Christ. We love one another the way you have loved us, O Lord. Forgive each other the way you have forgiven us, O Lord. Lord, again, that we will stand. The world will know that we are the children of God when they say that we are loving each other, O Father. Lord, enable us to love share your love with others also. So we thank you again for the body of Christ, the family of God that you brought us together. Lord, we pray your blessings again, O Lord. Next 10 years, we pray, Father, if we are alive, if you are coming tarries, O Lord, enable us to see that hundreds of people, Lord, come to this place to serve you, O God. We pray that we'll be able to see the sick will be healed, O God. We pray that the backsliders will come back to you, O God. We pray that your kingdom will grow in this place for the glory of Jesus, we pray. Lord, we commit us again. We rededicate our life again for your glory, O God. Forgive us, we pray, Father, in our laziness, our shortcomings, O Father. Bless us together. We love you. We thank you. We praise you. In your precious name we pray. Amen. You be seated, please. Let us read God's word this morning again for a short meditation. So time is up almost. You know, we try to be again short now. So we try to make all these things feasible to the time and the situations that we are in. Turn your Bible to Psalm number 23. The one of the most famous scripture portion in the entire Bible. You all know these words. Next 5 weeks or so, maybe we will learn and read from this portion, and we'll study or remind the words. Nothing new I am going to say to any of you actually, but nothing, try to remind about God and his goodness into our lives from this portion. So let us read. I will read from NKJV. If you can read aloud with me, and I need some help from each of you actually, you can respond to me, read. So that will give me some time to breathe in between, so you can read along. Okay, let's read Psalm number 23, NKJV. Let us read together. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. Nor with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, my cup runs over. Surely, goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Psalm 23 is a psalm that I think all of you know by heart. Most of you know by heart. We read these times of sorrow. We read this at the hospital beds. We read when people mourn. You know, we read this in so many different contexts that we read Psalm 23. This is a song of comfort and confidence that we see. Charles Spurgeon said, this is the pearl of the Psalms. The pearl of Psalms. Someone else said like this, this is David's hymn of praise to the divine diligence. This is the David's hymn of praise for the divine diligence. So he is talking all, this all about, these six verses is all about the Lord, all about the shepherd, all about God and his care, his concerns. It's all about him. Nobody knows that exactly when David wrote these verses or this poem. But majority of the commentators agree that he may be writing this, maybe his in a later part of his life, he have seen enough of God's care, concern, God's protection, provisions, and everything in his life. That is where he might have wrote this song. Psalm 22, 23, and 24 are the same way that picturing about God, about Christ, what he has done. In Psalm 22, that we read about who Jesus is. Jesus is the dying for the sheep. Jesus is the good shepherd who dying for the sheep. In Psalms 24, he talk about the chief shepherd, he is going to come back. In between the psalm that we see, the Psalm 23, that the good shepherd taking care of his sheep. So in Psalm 22, 23, 24, you can read it together. 23, again, 22 talk about Jesus as our substitute who dies on the cross for us. In Psalm 23, we see he is the great shepherd who take care of us. And the chief shepherd, Psalm 24, is coming for us. Or we can say in another way, Psalm 22 is talking about the cross. Everything that we have in our life or who we are is simply because of the cross. Cross is the event, right? Cross is the event and everything that happens. So our past that we see in Psalm 22, our future that we see in Psalm 24, in between there is a time. So we all are saved by the cross, by the grace, by the mercy, by the blood of Jesus. And there is a day he is going to come. We are going to be with him. But in between we have to leave. So Psalm 23 come to that place. So we are saved in the past. We are going to be saved in the future. We are going to be with the Lord one day. We are going to be in home together with the Lord. But we have to live in this world in between. So Psalm 23 comes into that place. So during this time of difficulties and challenges, I think that this was a great psalm. I was reading this three times a day for all my lying down times actually. Keep on reading the same psalm again and again. So it's ministering, talking to our heart as we meditate on God's word like that. So today we look into the first verse of the psalm. And this is his declaration. We all know that. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want, or I don't lack nothing. So this is the declaration of David. This is the statement of faith of David. This is the creed of David. David says, this is what I believe. This is what I believe. What I believe? The Lord is my shepherd. The Lord is my shepherd. This is what I believe. This is a statement of faith. So we can declare this together. We can declare to our own personal life, as family, as individual, as congregation. We can declare that together, this statement of faith. The Lord is my shepherd. So there are many things, you know, simple things to remind ourselves. We can see that. The first thing that we see, the first word, the Lord is. The existence of God. The Lord is. Our life is built upon two unshakable foundations. Our life is built upon two unshakable foundations. That is very simple. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 6 that we read. Those who come to the Lord, they should believe that the Lord is. The Lord is the existence of God. And the second is the nature of God. He is the one who faithfully gives and dispenses his goodness those who diligently seek him. God is a giver. God is a provider. That is the second thing. The existence of God and the nature of God. Those are the two foundations our life is built upon. The Bible starts with that declaration. Bible is not arguing to prove that there is a God. The Bible is not trying to explain that the reason of the existence of God. Rather, the Bible starts with a declaration. It says that in the beginning, God. In the beginning, God. And Genesis gives us an explanation about who that God is then. There is only one God. He is the creator. He is the sustainer. He is the controller. And God created everything. The God of the Bible is set apart from creation. And God is not part of the creation. And Genesis chapter 1, 2, 3 itself is refuting all the isms of the world. And says that God exists. And he is above of everything else. That is the declaration that we see. So David here explains that. He says that the Lord exists. And we are privileged to know this God. How do we know about this God? Everything that God has revealed, that's only we know, right? In the nature God has revealed, as Paul says in Romans, through the special revelation, the scripture that we read and meditate and study and live, that is the special revelation. God revealed himself to us. Everything we know about God, we didn't find out, we didn't think it up, or we can imagine it. It is everything was revealed in his word. So David declares, he says, the Lord is. So we start there with the same thing. Our life starts with the understanding, belief, and faith, the existence of God. But who is this God? That is the second thing David says. David was a shepherd, by the way, right? So David being a shepherd, and now he is picturing himself as a sheep. And David became the king of Israel. But he is not afraid or ashamed to tell other people he was a shepherd before. But he knows something about shepherd, and he is bringing over here, and he declared that his shepherd is. The Lord is. The Lord. The Lord in the Bible, or in that place that we see that he talk about Jehovah, Yahweh. You know, there are two names that we see, the foundational names in the Old Testament, the Elohim and Yahweh. And there is a lot of names that is revealed in the Bible. The names of God is revealing the character of God, the nature of God. Again, God we will never able to comprehend in our mind. So the scripture gives us so much of God and his activities, his nature through his names. There is a lot of names. There is the at least 9 of the compound names that we see in this portion in Psalm 23 itself. So here David talk about what he says. He says about the Lord, the Yahweh, the great I am. That is a word that David is using over here. He not only says that a God, but he talk particularly about this God of Israel, the Yahweh, the unchanging one, the self-sustaining one. That is an important lesson also as we are trying to learn here. Remember that. Remember this. You know, when we talk about rest of these things, it is very important. Because the God that we serve, we should know the God that we serve, who that God is. David really know that God is. He says he is the great I am. He is the great I am. He is the Yahweh. He is a self-sufficient one, the self-existent one. Now, every entity in the world needs something else to, a reason to live. But God is only entity, doesn't need any external thing for his sustenance. Because God is, he sustained and he's self-sufficient in himself. When I say I am, or any one of you say I am, there should be a qualifier to go along with that. I am who? I am Alex. That's my name. I am a pastor. That's what I do. I am in Pave. That's where I live or in my place. Right? So there is a qualifier that is needed along with that. But when God says, remember that in Exodus chapter 3 when God was introducing or Moses asked this question, who are you, Lord? What was God's answer? I am that I am. This was the greatest name God has revealed. And the Jewish people hesitant to use that name. They don't even proclaim, use the name of God on their lips. Because that was the reverence that they have. Once in a year, the Day of Atonement, the high priest, after all the required sacrifices, he pronounced that name. They have the reverence. I believe and pray that that is a good thing that each one of us should have in our life. Children, that is a important, most essential thing and most basic thing at the same time, most important thing that we should have in our life, a holy reverence towards the name of God. A holy reverence about the things of God. So he is, and he is the same yesterday, today, and forever. The great I am. Dallas Willard writes, there is a book about Psalm 23 of Dallas Willard. He writes, The Life Lack Nothing. And Dallas Willard, it's a good book to read actually about Psalm 23. It's a different way that present actually. This is one of the quotations that he writes. So God's essential nature can be characterized in this way. God is an immaterial, intelligent, and free personal being of perfect goodness, wisdom, and power, who made the universe and continues to sustain it, as well as to govern and direct it in his providence. So this God we are talking about, David is talking about, God who doesn't need anybody's help to be sustained, the one who created everything out of nothing, the great I am, the beginning and the end. So this is the statement of faith he makes then. He says that the Lord is my shepherd. In the rest of the Psalm 23, look at Psalm 23. David says that is 9 different names of God, the compound names of God that we see over here. Psalm 23 verse 1. Look at there your Bibles, please. The Lord is my shepherd, Jehovah Rohi. The Lord is my shepherd. In verse 1, he is, I shall not want. The Lord, Jehovah Jireh. The God is our provider. In verse 2, again, he says that he makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. There are two words, two names that we see. The Jehovah Rapha, the God our healer. The Jehovah Tsidkenu, the Lord our righteousness in verse 3. Verse 4, he says that the Lord is there, Jehovah Shammah. In verse 5, he says the Lord is our banner. He prepared a table before my enemies. In verse 5, he says that he is my sanctifier, the God Makadesh. In verse 6, he says the Lord Most High, the God Jehovah El Elyon. So what we're trying to say is that, you understand, this is very essential, to know the God that we serve. No wonder that David is so confident and he's so content in this. He says, the Lord is my shepherd, because he knows his Lord. He knows his master. The third thing that we see in that word is that the nature of God. What kind of a God is this God? You fast forward all the way to the New Testament. John chapter 10, for your meditation this week, you read that. John chapter 10, where we read, Jesus himself introduced, I am the good shepherd. What kind of a shepherd is he? He says that the good shepherd lay down his life for his sheep. I know them, they know me. And that is what he talked about this. So this good shepherd is willing to give up his own life for his sheep. That is the shepherd that we serve. In the Old Testament again that we read in Isaiah chapter 40, verse 11, Isaiah 40, 11. He tends his flock like a shepherd. He gathers the lambs in his arms and carries them close to his heart. He gently leads those that have young. This is a God that we serve, his compassion, his gentleness, his care. This is a testimony of David, his nature. He's a God who gives us everything. We'll go further and faster here and try to finish early. The next thing is very important. He said, the Lord is my shepherd. The Lord is my shepherd. But if we can say the Lord is a shepherd, we can say the Lord is the shepherd. We can say the Lord is our shepherd. All those things are true. God is a shepherd. The Bible teaches that again about God's care for his people, how he leads his people. Talk about God is collectively our shepherd. That is also true. God is the shepherd. All other things are hirelings that we read again in John chapter 10. He is the shepherd. All those things are true. But here, this word is the most important in the entire psalm. If this won't make sense, none of the things will not make sense at all. Now, sometimes that when we read the scripture and all, or listen and or reading, many people yarn. This won't connect to them at all. You know why it is? It is not their fault at all. Don't misunderstand. It's not their fault at all. As long as you don't have a relationship with the author of the book, you will never able to connect with what is it is written. That's as simple as it is. You get that? As long as you have when you write a letter or a text or an email to your wife, you know, they may read that 20 times actually. If you are away from them, it is very meaningful, right? You get read actually, it is very boring. You may, out of curiosity, you may look one time, then you are done. Same way with reading the scripture, understanding God's mind. If you have a relationship with a shepherd, rest of the things. This is not a song of the seeker, but the song of singers, or song of the faithful. And they can sing this song because they can say what? The Lord is my shepherd. That is the thing that we have to see. Again, Haddon Robinson, one of the greatest preachers of our century, he said like this, probably the most important single word in the psalm is the little word my. You can know that the Lord is the shepherd, the only one in the universe who can fully meet your need. It is only when you have come to place your confidence in Him personally that you can sing with the David of the old, "The Lord is my shepherd." So again, look at that, look back then. David chose that word about who his God is. He says, "The great I am, the Lord is my shepherd." This is the nature of our God. Again, remember that. He is other than everything else, but He is ours. You can say that He is my Lord. He is powerful, but He is personal. You know, the Lord of the Bible is transcendent. He is above, beyond our comprehension and understanding. We'll never able to fathom or understand. We cannot bring it together in a box or bring together in our mind, in our collective things maybe. How smart we are, we'll never able to understand who God is. We'll never able to define God. God is transcendent. God is all-powerful. But God is immanent. He is Emmanuel. He is closer than my breath. That is the nature of this God that David experienced in his life. He says, He is majestic, but He is mine. He is mighty, but He is merciful. That is a God that we serve. He is a consuming fire, yet He is my sensitive shepherd. And so David says that this Lord is my shepherd. This Lord is my shepherd. The question we want to ask to everyone, especially my children, all of us, do you know this Lord as your shepherd? You say that the Lord is my dad's or mom's or my teachers or uncles and shepherd. Is this Lord is my shepherd? That is a relationship that we should have in our life. Philip Keller, another one who wrote about Psalm 23, he says, when the simple, though sublime statement is made that the Lord is my shepherd, it immediately implies a profound yet practical working relationship between a human being and his maker. It links the lump of common clay to divine destiny. It means a mere mortal become the cherished object of divine diligence. Listen this. To think that God in Christ is deeply concerned about me as a particular person immediately gives great purpose and enormous meaning to my short sojourn upon this planet. You understand that? You know, we are nobody. Psalm 8, you read that. Who are man to? For God to be concerned. But God is concerned about each of you, as we said. He is closer than our breath. A lump of clay, but He, you and I become the object of His devotion and affection. And David says that the Lord is my shepherd. John chapter 1 verse 12, those who listen to us, the Lord is not your shepherd any time. The Bible says that those who believe in their heart, confess through their mouth, God has given them the right to become the children of God. If you never put your trust in Jesus Christ, this is the way you become a child of God. You don't have to do anything. This is the good news of the gospel. You don't have to do anything to yearn and to receive this sonship or this to become the part of the family of God. Rather, you believe in Him. You can say that the Lord is my shepherd. But look at that. This is the greatest affirmation of faith. When you say that, the Lord is my shepherd. That is the greatest declaration of faith. When we say, you say, individually we say, the Lord is my shepherd. But there is something more than that. In John chapter 10, verse 11 through 15, we'll have the time to read it. Read that place. Jesus Himself says that. But I know my sheep, and they are mine. You know, when you say that Lord is my shepherd, that is the greatest statement of faith. But when He says that the sheep is mine, that is the greatest affirmation of grace. God called you. God called me as His. That is a relationship that David has with his shepherd. So when we say the Lord is our shepherd, what are we saying then? We are admitting that we are sheep. We are admitting that we are sheep. And we don't have to go much details about sheep and shepherd, all those things. But what does that mean? We understand that from the portions or other reading, we can understand that sheep are dirty creatures. They cannot clean themselves in that sense. You know, they are dependable creatures. They are defenseless creatures. When you say that, I cannot handle my life. I cannot do things by my strength. I cannot do anything by myself. I am just a sheep. That's what we say, the Lord is my sheep. And the second thing, when we say the Lord is my shepherd, we say we are declaring that He owns me. That's all it is needed. He owns me. You know, this is important. We are His by two ways. One, by creation. God has created each of you in His image and after His likeness. You are not by accident. You are not just a random chance. Rather, God in His divine wisdom created you and sent you this world. So He owns you. We are His. But as God's children, we have more privilege, because the Bible says that we are bought with a price. We are bought with a price. So you are belong to Him because He bought you with His precious blood. As we read in 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 18 and 19, we are not redeemed by perishable things as silver and gold. Rather, we are redeemed by the precious blood of the Lamb. You are God's. We are His. When we say that the Lord is my shepherd, I admit that I cannot run my life with my ability. But I have an owner. And the third thing, that is exactly, I believe, David says that, look at my master, look at my owner, look at my shepherd. I belongs to Him. I belongs to Him. Everything, rest of the things comes is that. David says that, then the Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. Another version says that I lack nothing. If you forget everything I say here, this is the essence of the things I want to tell you. This is what God comforted me during this time. The needs of the sheep is the responsibility of the shepherd. The needs of the sheep is the responsibility of the shepherd. The rest of the psalm we'll read again and again and again. I will repeat the same thing next coming weeks. But read if you can again. Everything you needed is the responsibility of the shepherd. I don't know where David got this idea. One, he got his experience. Other thing he might have read in the Old Testament, Deuteronomy chapter 2, verse 7, that Moses is reminding the people of God. In Deuteronomy chapter 2, verse 7, we read, the Lord your God has blessed you in all the work of your hands. He is reminding the new generation, those who are entering into the promised land. He is telling them these things, how God has brought them together. He has watched over your journey through His vast wilderness. You know, all remember all those stories in the Pentateuch. These 40 years, the Lord your God has been with you. You have not lacked anything. Brothers and sisters, my dear friends, God has given us everything we needed. That is what God has done, brought us this far. So David declared, he says that, look at my shepherd. I lack nothing under His management, under His care. Everything that I needed, the Lord has given to me. That doesn't mean that David didn't have any problems in his life at all. In the Bible wrote a lot about David. David is the only one who gave this much of space in the entire scripture, we see. You can read majority of those things are about his troubles. So it doesn't mean that you will not have a trouble. That's what we read rest of the verses later. Jesus Himself has said in John chapter 16, verse 33, in this world you will have troubles. But take heart that I have overcome the world. You will have troubles. That is part of it. David has his own challenges in his life. But David here says that the Lord is my shepherd. I shall not be in want. I am completely satisfied with His management of my life. Why? Because His name is on me. In later he says that He leads me to the path of righteousness for His namesake. So when you have a need, that is His responsibility. Because He has put His name upon you. That is what God is caring each one of us in such a way. He is the owner. He delights in His flock. That is what Jesus Himself has said in John chapter 10, verse 11. The good shepherd gave His life for His sheep. And Paul later questioned that, and he says in Romans chapter 8, verse 32, the rhetoric questions he is bringing. He did not spare His own Son, gave Him up for all. Along with that, He will not give you all things. He's challenging. If the shepherd is willing to give up His life, if that is the case, what else He will not give along with that? Bible says that again, David himself has said in Psalm 68, verse 19. This was another favorite verse that this season I was reading again. Praise be to the Lord, our God, our Savior, who daily bears our burden. He carries our burden every single day. Psalm 21, verse 3, David writes again, He who watches over you will not slumber. So if the Lord is your shepherd, that is all you need. Everything we need is in Him. We are complete in Him. There was an old story. It says that somebody asked a little child to read Psalm 23. This is what he read. The Lord is my shepherd. That's all I want. She had a great faith, actually. That is what exactly what we say. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. We are complete in Jesus Christ. The Bible says in Colossians chapter 1, verse 2, Colossians chapter 2, verse 9 and 10. The fullness of the Godhead boldly dwells in him. We are complete in him. You are complete in Christ, not Christ plus or Christ minus. You are complete in him. If Jesus is our provider, that is what makes us all the contentment into our life. Paul writes again in Philippians chapter 4, verse 19. Our God shall supply all our needs according to the riches of his glory in Christ Jesus. You know what David is trying to say here? He says that the shepherd knows the sheep's need better than the sheep knows. God knows your need better than you know. The Dr. Masons talk about the providential windy path of God. Last week, Finney talked about the God's grace and mercy and God's presence upon Joseph's life. All those stories that tells us what? God knows what you need even before you know it. That is the doctrine of providence of God. God knows everything that we need, whatever we need in your life. That is what exactly. There is a huge difference between this shepherd and all other shepherds in the world. All other shepherds may be able to provide the things for their sheep. But there is a difference between the shepherd that David talked about or what the Bible introduces. He is everything that we need. He is, this shepherd is everything that we need. If you are hungry, he is the bread of life. If you are thirsty, he is the living water. If you are in the dark, he is the light. If you are lost, he is the way. If you are confused, he is the truth. If you are dying, he is the life. If you are lonely, he is the companion. If you are sick, he is the healer. Everything you need, he has it. If he doesn't have it, you don't need it. Everything you have, you need it, he has it. If he hasn't has it, you don't need it. Because everything he is, not only giving something to us, he is it to us. This morning, brothers and sisters, would you please pray? We can declare this statement together. The Lord is, you say individually, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. I will read this, the paraphrase of this. Somebody wrote like this. I don't know who wrote it. It says like this. The Lord is my shepherd, that is relationship. I shall not want, that is supply. He makes me lie down in green pastures, that is rest. He leads me beside the still waters, that is refreshment. He restores my soul, that is healing. He leads me in the paths of righteousness, that is guidance. For his name's sake, that is purpose. Yea, though I walk through the valley of shadow of death, I will fear no evil, that is protection. For you are with me, that is faithfulness. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me, that is comfort. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies, that is hope. You anoint my head with oil, that is consecration. My cup runs over, that is abundance. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, that is blessing. And I will dwell in the house of the Lord, that is security forever, that is eternity. You, whatever you need, it is in him. Would you please pray this morning and declare that statement. Throughout this week, I encourage you to read these six verses, memorize it and repeat that again and again. The question we have to ask to ourselves is this: do you know the shepherd in such a way? There is an old story. It says that the preachers used to say, you know, there is an actor asked to read a Psalm 23. He came to the stage with a profound, deep voice. With enunciation and dramatic way, he read Psalm 23, the Lord is my shepherd. The audience stand in awe and in a standing ovation to this way that he presented. After that, an old preacher came, asked to recite the same thing. The old preacher recited from his mind Psalm 23 in his rough, broken voice after preaching for all these years. And people were in tears. Somebody asked the actor, what was the difference? The actor said, I know the psalm, but he knows the shepherd. That is the difference. We go through challenges in our life. We throw through difficulties like David. But we can say that I know my shepherd. Not only that I know the shepherd, he knows me. That makes the difference. I don't know what is your need today. You may be lonely in this season. He is the great shepherd. He is the great companion. You may be confused. He is the truth. If you are sick, he is the healer. Now, if you are worried and concerned about your future, He is the Jehovah Jireh, your provider. He knows what you need. He knows He is closer than our breath. Let us pray together as we sing again the last song. And anybody, those who listen to us this morning, we again challenge, and our children, anyone else, you know, we don't assume anybody's salvation. Do you know this shepherd? Do you know this shepherd? Do you really belong to Him? Do you really recognize His right to your life? Do you respond to His authority as the Lord of your life? If you find freedom and complete fulfillment in His life, can you boldly say that the Lord is my shepherd? I am complete in Him. I shall not want anything else. You know, the entire Bible from cover to cover you read, there is only one word that stands out every single time. You know, 158 plus times that itself is said, trust me. But the word trust is used hundreds of times in the entire Bible. I was thinking about this. No matter who preaches, no matter who teaches, no matter what you read, the essence of everything is the same thing. Trust, trust, trust. Psalm 23 is the greatest declaration of trust. The Lord is my shepherd. Let's close our eyes for a minute as we are going to sing and praise the Lord together. Let us thank the Lord for His goodness in your life. His faithfulness is beyond our comprehension. Let us meditate and respond to God's word this morning. The Lord is my shepherd. Don't be afraid, don't be anxious, don't be worried, don't be concerned. When we know that this Lord, the great I Am, the one who sustains everything, the one who created everything out of nothing, is my honor. David tells her, look at, hey, see my honor, see my shepherd. That is what he's boasting in his master. Oh, church, let us do that together as we worship. Let us boast in our God, the Lord is my shepherd. The offering also as we sing. Truth we already know, but we remind ourselves during this season. Read the rest of the verses. We read this: the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He leads me, He makes me lie down to the green pastures, He leads me to the still waters. He guides me to the path of righteousness for His name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of shadow of death, I'll fear no evil. No matter what that comes this week or in future, I will fear no evil, because Your rod that protect, Your staff that comfort me. You prepare a table before my enemies. The problem is still there, but God makes a solution, a way. My cup runs over. There is abundance of God's grace always with Him. My head is anointed with His oil. There is a joy in His presence. There's no purpose in His presence. Surely goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life. I will dwell in the Lord's presence forever. So would you please pray with the faith? We have been praying for many things during this week and season. We are grateful God answering our prayers. Many of our dear ones are going through very challenging times in their life, physically, financially, emotionally, relationally, in various ways. Some of the things are very obvious, easy to pray. Some of the things are not. But remember that the Lord is your shepherd, my shepherd. I lack nothing. Whatever I need, He has it. If He doesn't have it, I don't need it. He is our solution. He is our provider. Not only He has, He is the great I am. Let us put our trust in Him and pray. After this, as we finish, if you need prayer, come together. We pray with you. That is an honor to pray together. That is a joy. We can pray together. If you have a need, we'll stand here to pray for you. Just want to leave, they can leave. You can go to the fellowship hall. There is coffee, and you can spend time to talk to each other. Let's close together as we pray. Dear Father, our great shepherd, our Lord, our Master, our Savior, our Redeemer, our Sustainer, our Friend, oh God, we thank you for this great relationship. Lord, we will never be able to understand why you have loved us this much. But we know that He who died for us, gave up Himself for us, you will give us everything that we needed along with that. So Lord, sometimes we worry, we are anxious, we are concerned, because we cannot see the next moment. We are grateful we have our shepherd. He knows everything, our past, our present, our future, all at the same time. Lord, we are comforted to know that nothing surprises you. Lord, we are taken back when we see and hear and things that happens. But Lord, you have seen every moment even before it happens. As David said, Lord, we know that our times are in your hand. So you are our shepherd this week. Lord, we pray that enable us to put our trust more and more in you. Cling on to you. Lord, pray with that faith and hope. Trust in our hearts and lives of Father. Lord, I pray for those who are sick in their bodies, those who are going through challenging times, Lord, in different ways. We pray that this healing, Jehovah Rapha, the one who restores, the one who comforts, the one who heals, God, we pray that you be with them. We pray for all our children, those who are going back to school this week. We pray for us, we start the Sunday school in person next week. Lord, we pray for our youngsters, those who are in the high schools, our college students, those who are away from us, those who are in the domes, and those who are away from us, we pray for them again, O Father. Be with them, protect them. We pray. Our ladies, elders, Lord, the team, those who are faithfully serve you week after week, we pray, establish the work of their hand. Lord, as we leave this place, help us to love you with all our heart, mind, and strength. Love each other the way that we love ourselves. Lord, enable us to share this love, everyone, those who come across our life, O Father. Bless us together. We thank you again for everything you have done for us as it serves. We love you, we praise you, we glorify you, Lord, in your precious and matchless name. Let's stand together for the benediction.
Praise God from whom?
praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. God, we praise you. God, we praise you.
Now may the God of peace, who brought up our Lord Jesus from the dead, the great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you complete in every good work to do his will, working in you what is well pleasing in his sight. Forever and ever. Amen. Amen. God bless you all. Have a great week. Again, the fellowship hall is open. You can go. And if you need prayer, somebody want to pray with you, we'll be honored to do that. You can come. We can pray with you. And God bless you all.